everybody. Joel Colander here again, Rock Island Auction Company, here to show you one of the items coming up on day three, so tomorrow, of our February 3rd through 6th Sporting and Collector Firearms Auction. And before I begin, let me just say, bring up the PIAT. Developed at the peak of World War II, it sort of unveiled onto the battlefield, but its history goes back a little further. Because prior to these, we had boys' anti-tank rifles. You know, they're chambered in .55 boys. They were very, very effective for a while. But as is the nature of the battlefield, especially in World War II, weapons and technology keep evolving. And so it wasn't too long before the boys' anti-tank rifle was officially obsolete. It could no longer penetrate the thicker, stronger armor of enemy tanks. And so the sort of arms war between anti-tank and tank armament just keeps on going. One of the next steps is the PIAT. Now, PIAT is P-I-A-T. That stands for Projector, Infantry, Anti-Tank. It's a British design weapon, and what is essentially a shoulder-mounted spigot mortar. So instead of a mortar with just a hollow tube that you can drop a charge down, you'll notice here there's a post on here, the spigot, if you will, which you can fit your projectile over the top of, and then mount this on your shoulder and launch it. Now you notice the monopod here in most of the period photos. You see someone is laying prone with this. And admittedly, to some, it looks strange. It definitely is not what we typically think of with shoulder-mounted launchers that we're used to, like the later bazooka, the later RPGs and things of that nature. It is different. Now, one of the major common misconceptions of the PIAT is that it is a spring-powered launcher. And indeed, these two lots also come with additional springs, replacement springs, but I do say that is a misconception. The spring is largely designed primarily to mitigate the recoil that's going to be experienced when essentially mortar is being fired from your shoulder. It's also part of the firing mechanism as well. And for a bit of a strange contraption, you have a cheap to produce, remarkably efficient weapon. Now what these would take is a 2.5 pound projectile, with a direct fire range of about 100 yards. Indirect fire would be about 350 yards. And this is, like I said, a 2.5 pound projectile that's capable of piercing 4 inches of armor, or 100 millimeters. And with capabilities like that, it's definitely an upgrade over the boys' anti-tank rifle. Not to mention, it's a little more compact nature, makes it easier to transport, although it is 35 pounds. Again, helping to mitigate some recoil. This is no lightweight weapon for sure, despite like the big hollow portion up here. You'd assume a largely empty tube, it should be lighter than that. It is definitely not. This would have been a beast to lug around the Western European battlefields. Now, also a common misconception with the PIAT, as you would expect from perhaps a mortar launching a shoulder device, that it would have a giant recoil. In fact, the spring is so large and strong to mitigate that. It was a very considered part of the design for these. So historically, men may not have liked them because there was this perceived large recoil, probably no different or minimally different than the boys' anti-tank rifle. So they're similar in recoil to the boys. They have increased destructive capability to the boys, and they were used with great efficiency, as was the boys' anti-tank rifle. There are numerous medal citations for men using the PIAT, of course, because you had to be within 100 yards of your target, so it took an incredible amount of bravery to get close enough to enemy armor to utilize a PIAT. In fact, during Operation Overlord, aka the D-Day invasions, if you will, PIATs are said to have accounted for 7% of German armor destruction, which was more than the Allied air power, which clocked in at 6%. So if you're wondering how efficient can a 35-pound shoulder-mounted mortar essentially be, there's your answer. Now, these two examples will be offered midway through day three. You have lot 4725 and 4551 if you're searching for those things on our website. They both have an additional recoil spring. They both have the clamp-on monopod. Neither one has the butt pad, which obviously a soldier back in World War II probably would have found pretty advantageous if they have a similar kick to a boy's anti-tank rifle. So the PIAT, despite its capability and destructive power, would eventually be phased out by the introduction of, say, recoilless rifles and shoulder-propelled rockets, of course, as the evolution of the battlefield continued. However, it leaves behind just a really interesting, ingenuitive way of solving a problem and doing so in the midst of World War II. Pretty incredible stuff. Of course, if you're interested in learning more about the PIAT, we would recommend Matthew Moss's book, cleverly titled The PIAT. Britain's anti-tank weapon in World War II. You can also find his work over at historicalfirearms.info and the Armorer's Bench, really doing some good scholarly work over there. They come highly recommended. If you're interested in actually purchasing a Piat, of course, you can head over to rockislandauction.com. You can look at these items. You can place bids right on the website, not only on these, but of course, nearly 5,000 lots, over 8,700 other firearms. But of course, by the time you watch this, a couple of those will be sold already. Thanks for watching, everybody. Be sure to give us a subscribe, and until next time, keep your powder dry.